Good morning, everyone. I appreciate the invitation to come talk, and I'll tell you a little bit about the work we've been doing at the University of Tennessee. I am going to point out, though, that the title is a little bit of a lie. Our lipidomics platform isn't quite ready for prime time, and so we're just going to talk about metabolomics and kinetics flux profiling today. I wanted to start the talk not by introducing metabolomics again, because there's no way I could do it as eloquently as people did yesterday, but I do want to tell you about the platform that we have at the University of Tennessee, Knoxville. Currently, we have both a targeted and an untargeted platform that consists of four instruments. We actually started only using the targeted platform, and most of the data that I'm going to present today actually comes from that. The instrument is an HPLC triple quadrupole. On that instrument, we pretty much replicated the methods of Rabinowitz and co-workers, which is where I did my postdoc. And our capabilities were to measure 120 known water-soluble compounds and to do flux analyses. These 120 known water-soluble compounds come from a library of 400 molecules that we injected and looked for MRM and SRM parameters for them. As you all know, the targeted methods don't allow molecular discovery, and a real drawback of this technique, for us at least, was the fact that it took 2 hours to analyze each sample. We needed two analyses for each of them, one in positive mode, one in negative mode. The positive mode analysis used an aminopropyl helix chromatography, and the negative mode analysis used a C18 with an ion pairing reagent and tributylamine. Obviously, there are some tricks to getting ion pairing reagents out of a column before you run an analysis in the opposite mode, and so they were relatively slow. Nonetheless, this was a workhorse for a long time, and we got a lot done on that. Recently, we have bought three UPLC Orbitraps, or I should say the university has bought them for us. Kind donation there. These are Exactive Plus instruments. Again, for the water-soluble compounds, we've in-housed the methods of Rabinowitz and co-workers, where we can analyze the sample now in about a half hour using tributylamine ion pairing reagent in a negative mode analysis only. We are measuring about 150 known water-soluble compounds, and we do flux analyses routinely on this instrument as well. I will point out that I am being very, very stringent here on what I'm calling known. If I haven't had a standard in my hand and injected it in the instrument, I'm not going to call it a known compound. We can match many more of the 10,000 spectral features to libraries and so on and so forth, but we don't really have the confidence of what they are. And so we're going to focus today just on things that have been confirmed with addition of standards. To complement that instrument, we also have two other Orbitraps. One, we're developing an in-house method to look for lipid-like compounds. We see a lot of things. The short story is we don't quite know what they are yet. And we're really trying to figure out on the analytical side of things, is all ion fragmentation going to be a usable way to confirm lipid structures without having to have a pre-trap like a quadrupole or an ion trap in front of the Orbitrap mass analyzer. The third instrument is actually the one where I personally think we have the most fun. It's just sort of sitting there for unique analyses, which a variety of collaborators come and work with us on. And we use it for a lot of technology development and really trying to probe the analytical chemistry behind these standalone Orbitrap instruments. And we're doing a lot of statistics and a lot of validation there. We also now have an inline UV-Vis with the third Orbitrap, and we're really trying to see if you can take both optical information as well as mass spectral information and have better confirmation of the two. And then coming soon, we're going to acquire a quadrupole Orbitrap instrument so we can do more structural elucidation and also hopefully get into the realm of glycomics. And so with the platform out of the way, I'm just going to dive into talking about some of the biology and the studies we're doing there. Oh, actually, I'm going to introduce the fact that we've also found that since we work primarily on microbial systems, that metabolite concentrations alone often really aren't sufficient to tell us the dynamics of what is going on in these samples. And the reason that they're not, if you think about it, a microorganism, especially ones from the environment, can find themselves in drastically different nutrient availability conditions very rapidly. And so I'm going to talk about some oceanographic work today. 1 minute you could be in the water, the next minute you could be in the sea spray, and a minute later you could be in a fish. And so there seems to be a lot of evolutionary pressure to keep your concentrations the same unless there are dramatic reasons to alter them. Instead, what we find is that our concentrations, or I'll call them pool sizes, don't tell us much, but often the flux of the system or the passage of a labeled metabolite through the system is far more informative, and it seems that a lot of these organisms turn pathways on or off to really alter their metabolism. Now, if we were working at steady state with the kinetic flux profiling that you've seen from a lot of people, you can make some assumptions as to what's going on, do some relatively simple differential equations, and build a model of the system. Unfortunately, in a lot of the cases where we work, we're not able to assume steady state, and so one of the open questions today that we're going to talk about as we go through, can you do flux-based profiling on systems where you can't assume steady state and still get some reasonable biological information out of that? And so most of our work to date has actually been in the oceanographic realm. When I went to Tennessee, I had started life as an organic chemist and then done some metabolomics, and I wanted to do drug profiling. And then I realized that there's no medical school and that there was this really great scientific community there, even though we're not close to an ocean, that was interested in the marine sciences. And so when one thinks about what happens in the world's oceans, it's the largest biome on the world. There's tons of CO2, actually megatons of CO2 that are fixed every year. And when they flow through the food web, they go through phytoplankton, which are photosynthetic, either small ones like Prochlorococcus or large ones like Trichodesmium, which we might get to talk to today. They fix the CO2 into carbon sources that heterotrophic bacteria can use. It either goes directly through engulfing the smaller phytoplankton, or either goes into the dissolved organic matter or particular organic matter, which can then be taken up by heterotrophic bacteria. The heterotrophic bacteria, by a variety of mechanisms, are eaten by protists, and then eventually this ends up into zooplankton, like whales and so on and so forth. And so this is how carbon dioxide, large amounts of it, are put into the food web in the ocean. There are also two other important factors that one must think about, is dissolved organic matter and particulate organic matter often will mineralize or become recalcitrant and they move to the world's oceans. That's one of the ways in which the ocean takes CO2 out of the atmosphere and removes it from our environment. But, actually wasn't discovered until about 1999, people realized that viruses in the ocean also contribute to this cycle. And so while we have the microbial pump, which moves CO2 into the sediment, we also have what they call the viral shunt, which can re-liberate dissolved organic matter and particulate organic matter and keep it available for microorganisms and eventually other organisms in the ocean. Now, the fact that viral lysis or viruses in the ocean wasn't discovered until 1999 by Wilhelm and Suttle is in and of itself a very interesting phenomenon. And then on top of that, now that people realize that viruses are there, 30 to 50% of all microbes in the ocean are turned over by viral lysis or death every day. And so it's a major player in this very, very large microbiome. That being said, really we know very little about it other than that viruses are there and a lot of things die. And so the first project that I'm going to talk about, and based on time, the last one, I promise I'll try to keep us on pace, is going to really look at a model virus system where we're trying to use metabolomics to see if we can understand how the virus alters the metabolism in this species. Now, if one looks in the literature, there's actually not a lot of reported metabolomic studies on viruses in general, but if we go to our model system, which is phages that infect E. coli, we see a trend where what we find is as the phage infects the host, it turns off host cell DNA synthesis, it degrades the host cell DNA, it builds machinery for viral reproduction, then it ramps up DNA synthesis and replicates. And so it specifically goes in and reprograms the host to synthesize itself. This is also seen in human cytomegalovirus, where lipid synthesis is redirected to build an envelope for the host. Now, in the marine world, people know that many viruses contain auxiliary metabolic genes, and so they can enter a host and produce a gene or two. And in some marine cyanophage, people have found that the virus itself can actually photosynthesize to provide more organism for the host. But these studies, while they were in very good journals and are very convincing, were in low abundance organisms. Now, the other thing that is sort of out there in the field is that people believe that phage host systems appear to sequester sufficient resources for nucleic acid synthesis from the degradation of host DNA. But no one had proven that. That's all based on really looking back at how DNA or phage synthesis works in E. coli. And so we entered this world expecting that we were going to study this new host phage system that I'll talk about in a minute, It was going to lead to specific alterations. We were going to use metabolomics to go in and figure out what they were. And it was very interesting to us because the species, Roseobacter 2047, was an environmental isolate that had come from the Bergen mesocosm. It was unsequenced at the time that we had started the study. And we had also isolated, Allison Buck and our collaborator had isolated, a roseophage that affects this Sulfitobacter 2047 called Roseophage 2047B. And it was a nice system. It was looked like tractable laboratory system. And it's important because the Roseobacter clade makes up about 30 to 50% of all bacteria in coastal waters. It's a very diverse clade. I'm not saying it's a single species, but there's a lot of them there. And so once we started looking at the system and got the genetics and the genomics back afterwards and had this organism fully sequenced, we actually found that it was a lot more interesting system than we had initially thought. The Roseobacter itself looks much like a gram-negative bacterium that one would see on land, but it actually came with a lysogenic phage, which has inserted itself in the genome, that is always there with the Roseobacter, that was had 85% sequence homology to the lytic roseophage that had been co-isolated with the Sulfitobacter species. We don't understand much about the phage dynamics other than that the lysogenic phage, which is Roseophage 2047A, will not come out of the genome and start an infection under any conditions that we've ever seen other than viral infection by its seemingly close cousin. And so that's the only way we can get both phages to replicate is by infecting with this lytic phage that was isolated. And so that being said, when we look at the growth dynamics of the organism, post-inoculation, you can see that the Roseobacter itself, if we haven't added any lytic phage, grows just fine. If you add the lytic phage at a multiplicity of infection of 3 at the beginning of the experiment, at about 240 minutes post-infection, you can see that the population starts to crash, but it never dies off. So there's a lot of bacteria that are left at the end. When one looks at the phage count, you can see that numerically phage dominate over top of the bacterium over the course of the experiment. And all of the phage number were done by quantitative PCR. And so it was an interesting system to look into. And so when we went in and initiated this, we started making some estimates of the carbon, just to give you an idea of the expectations you would have at the onset of the experiment. And so here, using some information about the total femtograms of carbon in both the cell and the expected viruses, you can see that the uninfected culture will have more carbon put into biomass after 480 minutes, which is expected. But if you look at the virally infected culture, what you can see is that the cells actually decrease a little in biomass, but you need a lot of resources and a lot of carbon, or a lot more resources and a lot more carbon than the uninfected culture would have to support viral replication. And so this should be a major pump into particulate organic matter or viruses in the ocean. And so at this point, we were actually going to do metabolomics at each of these time points in a flux-based analysis, which I'll point out the time in a little bit because it escapes my mind, and see what alterations happen in the course of the cycle. We also wanted to look into one other thing, which was to go in and figure out if viral lysis changed the dissolved organic matter composition, and so because that would change nutrient availability for other species in the environment. And so the first thing we'll talk about is actually looking at the release metabolites that are in the supernatants between the infected and uninfected cell populations. Now, I'll point out that this is a targeted method, and so we're definitely biased towards small molecules, but some great work at Woods Hole Oceanographic Institute has pointed out that the peptides and the larger things tend to be recalcitrant anyway. So our question was, were these small molecules that should be relatively easily utilized by other organisms, would they build up after viral infection? And I think our initial incredibly naive hypothesis would be that everything is going to be way up, right? You have cells that are metabolically active, they're lysed, and all the concentrations should be high. Instead, what you see that it's about a 50-50 split between molecules that were built up in concentration and molecules that were actually lower in concentration as well. And so we could make the conclusion that while the nature of dissolved organic matter was different, it wasn't that viral lysis just did a net release of extra carbon into the environment. And if you go in and look, what you see is things that are up are the amino acids that are involved in stress response, acetyl-CoA, which we just think is too large to be transported back into the surviving cells, as well as the other CoAs. Glycolysis and gluconeogenesis has a sort of opposite trends, but most things actually either didn't change in concentration or were lower in concentration, which we think is due to active transport. You'll also note that there are some players that aren't shown here, so glutamate, which should be a major component of the cells, and some other things didn't appear in the supernatants, which was also interesting to us in the beginning. And so after we profiled the supernatants, we went in and we looked at the intracellular metabolites in these organisms. And here again is the time points that we took. The ones in black are the ones where we did flux-based analyses. And this is just a graph showing the percent significant changes in the metabolite pool. Now remember, based on coli phages, what we would expect is at time 0 to time 15, there would be a large alteration in metabolism. That alteration in metabolism would persist throughout the infection cycle. Instead, in our Sulfitobacter roseophage system, what we see is there's actually very minor changes in metabolism. Maybe 20% of the metabolites total were changed over the first 120 minutes of the infection. But once we saw active lysis, where the cell population started to change, metabolism very rapidly and very significantly became altered between the organisms. And so in this system, instead of reprogramming the host in the early stages, something seemed to happen at the late stages of the organism. When we go in and look at the data of the heat map, and we do no normalization, so this is just the total intracellular pool of metabolites, realizing that there are more cells in the uninfected population versus the infected population, what you can see is that the total number of metabolites in the culture doesn't alter very dramatically. And so we're not losing any specific thing or making any specific thing selectively. Instead, then, if you go and normalize by cell count, which we actually did, again, by qPCR, because cell debris and ODs were throwing off our measurements, what you can see is that in the infected population, starting at the point where viral lysis begins to occur at 240 minutes, that almost every metabolite raises in concentration, right? We were initially intrigued by that because we thought we were going to see specific alterations, but this led us to think that maybe what is happening in this system is that the surviving members are sort of cannibalizing their dying kin and importing all of these metabolites. Now, on a biochemical level, that's intriguing because if you look at E. coli and you look at the site occupancy and enzymes, if you pump more metabolites into E. coli, most of its enzymes are saturated with substrate anyway, and that doesn't lead to a net increase in the metabolic flux in the organism. And so here we actually didn't know if that was the case, and so we did some flux-based analyses where at 0 minutes and 240 minutes we added C13 labeled acetate. We added this at a concentration that was 3 times higher than the carbon we had provided the organisms, and we just measured the incorporation into as many metabolites as we possibly could. If you look here, this is just fraction labeled. The light lines or dashed lines are the C13 material, and the heavy lines are the C12 material, which in hindsight should have probably been reversed for clarity. And I won't show you all of the data. At 0 minutes, the two populations on a flux-based analysis are behaving exactly the same. At 240 minutes for 97 of the metabolites, it looks just like what we see for here for succinate and methylmalonate, that the rate of turnover for the metabolite pool is exactly identical between the two. However, when one goes back and looks at the concentrations, which are 4 to 8-fold higher, the virally infected population should be 400 to 600 or 800% more metabolically active in all pathways that were observed, which is an incredibly interesting result that these organisms, which have really evolved to work in a feast or famine environment, actually can take these resources in very rapidly. Now, there's one other interesting story that came out of this. If you look at the measurements from what we know of most cells, bacterial cells, they're really just bags of glutamate. It's about 300 millimolar with inside the cell, and it's the numerically most abundant metabolite in most gram-negative organisms. If you look at this, both glutamate and glutamine, the turnover rates of the pools was actually much slower in the virally infected populations. Doesn't quite make sense because most nitrogen assimilation should be coming in through these two metabolites here. And when you do the math, still the pools are much larger, and so we're 300 to 400% more active in our utilization of glutamate or glutamine, but there's something that is allowing them not to use de novo synthesis as their primary source for these metabolites. Instead, what we think is that these metabolites are actually being recycled from their lysed cousins. And so why the focus on glutamine and glutamate? Well, when one thinks about the world's oceans, carbon actually isn't the limiting nutrient, right? CO2 can come in and be photosynthesized, or through photosynthesis can be fixed into larger carbon sources fairly easily. And the first 50 meters are saturated in CO2 very readily, and actually probably the whole ocean is, even though I don't have those data off the top of my mind. And so it's actually nitrogen and phosphorus that limit growth in the world's oceans, and actually in other aquatic systems as well, which is why the use of nitrogenous fertilizers near the Great Lakes is so dangerous. And so if one goes in and starts to build the nitrogen budget for these organisms and uses the glutamate to glutamine ratio as an indicator of nitrogen stress, what you can see is the uninfected populations, as they grow and accrue biomass, actually lose glutamine as they make more glutamate, and the ratio indicates that they're becoming nitrogen limited near the end. Instead, in the population that's virally infected, you can see that they're able to maintain the glutamate to glutamine ratio, and by scavenging their lysed kin, the population as a whole actually gets around nutrient limitation. And so we think that there's actually a symbiotic relationship between the host and the phage in this case, where the phage obviously replicates, but as it does so, it allows the host to overcome nutrient limitations that it would have in the wild. We're now ground truthing this on some data that we've acquired from cruises from around the world, and are looking at adding actually, and I'm going to skip all this while I'm saying the last phrase, so don't worry. We're actually looking at adding fully labeled hosts that we've put through the lytic cycle in the lab back into the environment and seeing what parts of the host are uptaken by natural populations. So briefly, I just want to thank my group, both past and present, and I think my citation had actually fallen off the bottom. This work was recently published in the ISMI Journal, it's in press, and Amanda May was really the leader of it in my laboratory. All of the rest of them do a variety of really great things that we didn't talk about today, and I want to specifically mention the Oceans group. I said six because I didn't put my own name on there, but this work was done with Allison Buchan, but we've gone on cruises with both Ben Van Moy and Stephen Wilhelm now to sort of ground truth this in the environment. And thank you for your attention, and if there are any questions, I'll be glad to answer them.